Hello, I'm Valerie Biden Owens, chair of the Biden Institute at the University of Delaware. Today, I have the privilege of introducing State Senator Sarah McBride. Sarah has represented Delaware's first Senate district since 2020. She is the first openly transgender state senator in American history and the highest ranking elected transgender public official. As a point of personal privilege, I want to acknowledge that Sarah worked on my nephew Beau Biden's campaign for attorney general, and she is close to my family. My family holds her in high regard. Thank you, Senator, for being here today and for joining us on this episode of All Politics is Personal, a program where we introduce the public to the person behind the politician. Anyone can research your policies and accomplishments, but that's not what we're about today. We're here to talk about you. Tell us about what it was like growing up McBride.
Well, first off, thanks so much for having me. I'm really excited to be on this program with you. Great to be here at the Biden Institute in what is actually your brother's office and also my classroom.
I let him use it.
It's very kind of you. Yes. It's very kind of you. It's a good office. My childhood was really idyllic. I grew up with two older brothers, 8 and 10 years older than me. So when I was a kid, they were in the house. But when I was a teenager, I basically had full run of the place. Two amazing parents. I always say I lucked out in the parent lottery. My mom, Sally, and my dad, Dave. And so it was a really idyllic childhood. Really could have been right out of the 1950s, tag every day after school with friends. Yeah. But it was also a childhood that behind the joy and the fun and the really close-knit family was a childhood of struggle. As you mentioned, I'm transgender. And despite having such a wonderful and frankly privileged upbringing, much of my childhood was spent struggling with who I am and trying to figure out how I fit into this world. Because as a young person who's LGBTQ, I think you're forced to grapple with a lot of existential questions. What is a life well lived? What is an authentic life? What is a fulfilling life? And also, as you get older, you begin to take in the fact that this world is just not built for someone like you. And so it was a lot of joy, but also a lot of fear that the heart of my community and my country was just not big enough to love someone like me.
Who did you talk to?
No one. No one. I think for me, that fact was my deepest secret. And I knew that if I shared it with anyone, that that would mean that I had to accept that it was true about myself. And I couldn't verbalize it to other people because I was afraid that if I told one person, it would mean one, I would be accepting this fact. And I was scared to do that. But also, too, I was worried that if I told someone, my world would come crashing down. I worried that I'd let down my family, that I'd lose my friends, that I'd give up on any opportunity, any dream I might have had as a kid. Because at that point, there weren't examples of people like me who were out and happy, healthy, embraced by their communities, pursuing their dreams. And as they say, it's difficult to be what you can't see. And I didn't have anyone that I could see. And so I didn't know that it was possible.
Was this fear with you as a constant, or would it just come and go? And when did it start?
As early as I can remember. My earliest memories are of lying in my bed at night, praying that I would wake up the next day and be myself. And, you know, at the start, it was a fleeting fact. It was something I thought about, you know, maybe once a day, maybe a couple times a day. It got to the point when I was in my teenage years that it was a fact I thought about every single waking hour of every single day. And I think it's really difficult when we're talking about transgender people, because with gay folks, people who aren't gay understand what it feels like to love and to lust, and so they're able to enter into conversations with an analogous experience, but it's really hard to understand what it feels like to be trans. And for me, the closest thing that I can compare it to was just a constant feeling of homesickness, an unwavering ache in the pit of my stomach that would only go away when I could be seen and affirmed as myself.
What did you do to alleviate the ache or the fear or the pain? Did you have hobbies, or did you immerse yourself in sports, or what did you do?
I didn't have enough talent to immerse myself in sports. I really at a young age wanted to be an architect, so I loved building. I still think it's the most beautiful art form. I also loved movies, and I actually went to a public magnet art school for middle school and high school, where I majored in film. So I loved making movies, and then I got involved in politics. I worked for your nephew's campaign in high school. For your daughter, actually, was my first one of my first bosses.
Yeah.
But I got involved in all of those things, film and politics, I think, for similar reasons. Because film was a way of trying to sort of escape my life and jump into the shoes of someone else, try to escape that pain. It was also a way for me to make sense of the world and try to see it through different perspectives, and frankly, to try to see the world through the beauty of film, because I wasn't able to see the beauty of the world in my own life because I was just so consumed with this pain. I was missing the beauty in the world. And then politics, I think, for a similar reason. I told myself that if I could get involved, if I could make a difference, if I could make my life mean something, then perhaps that would compensate for the pain or fill the void, heal the pain, and maybe make it worthwhile to stay in the closet. Because I thought, the only way I can make a difference is to stay in the closet. But if I make a difference, maybe that'll make staying in the closet worthwhile. Because I can almost live vicariously through other people, through the change that I bring.
Boy. The movies that you made, and you went to middle and high school, middle school and high school. What kind of movies did you make?
A lot of different kinds of movies.
You wrote these movies yourself?
A lot of times they were improvised. Or we'd like sketch out an outline of the movie and then essentially improvise the movie.
Video or film? How did you?
Yeah, so we had like digital cameras, and it was at the sort of start of families having digital camcorders, and I could edit on a little laptop, Mac laptop, with iMovie, which is their basic program. And a lot of times it was, you know, dumb things that a kid might make. Other times it was an opportunity for me to actually play myself.
So it's fascinating listening to you. Some of your movies were fiction, and some were self-expression, or?
A mix of all. Some were.
Did you do this after high school, when you went to college?
I didn't.
To American University?
I didn't. So I did film in middle school and high school and in elementary school. I started with a friend who had a camcorder, went over to his house, and we used to just make movies there in fourth and fifth grade. Terrible. I mean, just horrible movies. In college, though, I stopped doing film. I majored in government at American University. And so I went to the art school because it was sort of an outlet for my passion, but I ended up going to college and majored in government, did student government, which I had also done throughout school, and became student body president at American University during my sophomore year.
So you are in college.
Yes.
And you are sophomore and you run for?
Student body president.
And did you stay sophomore, junior, and senior year in the student government, or did you do a one-year run?
So I got elected at the end of my sophomore year to serve during my junior year. Theoretically, I could have run for re-election, but I felt like you're in college for 4 years. If I took the presidency for 2 years, if I could get reelected, that would sort of hog that opportunity, because it was not just an opportunity to make change, it was also an opportunity to grow and to learn, and I felt it was important for someone else to have that opportunity since we're on campus for only 4 years.
What did you run on?
Good question. I ran on building an American university that was accessible, and inclusive for everyone.
Were they engaged? Was the campus engaged? Today, we read so much about Gen Z, and it was poo-pooed before they weren't going to vote, and which thank God they did, or my brother wouldn't be where he is today. But the concerns of the Gen Z students, young people, not mm-hmm. just students, and with climate and guns and the inequities in the whole system, and was there a ripple of that at the time that you were at the American? Did the student body generally go along, or was always there just a small portion?
Well, that's a great question, and there's sort of two answers. So first, I went to school. I turned 18 in August of 2008. So my first election that I was voting in was when the Obama Biden ticket got elected for the first time.
Such a and wise choice.
What? Yes. what an election. Yeah. To come of age in. I will forever be and feel hopeful. Because my formative years of becoming involved was around that election. And, you know, coming into college in the aftermath of Obama getting elected, I remember I went to the freshman year, first semester, I sat in the gallery of the Senate when they voted on the Affordable Care Act. And so it was an incredibly exciting time. American is unique, because American is consistently ranked one of the most politically active campuses in the country. What I think we suffered from and what I tried to combat as student body president was you can't change your country if you can't change your community. Mm-hmm. And yes, there are a lot of opportunities in DC to intern, to work at national nonprofits, to intern on the Hill, to intern in the White House. Those are great opportunities. But don't ignore the opportunities for change and growth, personal growth, that are right in front of you.
Did you find other members of the community and your college who represent, who are like you? Or were you still a singular, felt as if you were a singular person in that sea of the campus?
A little bit of both. So I was still in the closet when I got elected. And
may I ask another question?
Yeah.
When you got elected and you were in the closet, did you feel or assume or think that someone else out there was alone, like you said you were alone? I mean, was there ever able to come together?
By that point, I had, because of the internet, I had realized that I wasn't completely alone. When I was growing up, I felt completely alone. And then I remember, you know, when I first got my computer in probably late middle school or high school, and I remember Googling this word that I had learned because I was watching a sitcom with my mom. And during the course of one of the episodes, a guest character is introduced, and it's revealed during the episode that she's transgender. And I remember turning to my mom and saying, is that real? Or are there people like this? I was probably 11 years old. And she said, yeah, they're called transgender or something like that. She probably didn't even use that word because this was 2000 or so, and there wasn't much public awareness. And so I remember Googling transgender and looking up people who were like me. So by the time I got to college, I knew I wasn't completely alone, but I had never met a transgender person. And I do remember on campus there was one student who I met while I was student body president in passing who I think was transgender. But I never had a conversation with someone who was like me. I only knew of folks like me through the internet. I remember reading about Amanda Simpson, who was appointed in the Obama-Biden administration to a position, first transgender woman ever to receive any kind of appointment by a president. And that was one of the first instances where I saw, oh my gosh, you can be transgender and do other things. You can be transgender and be successful. You can be transgender and be part of your government. That seemed so impossible to me that it was almost incomprehensible.
Was that the light switch that clicked?
By the time I was student body president, I had told myself, if I can just make my family proud, if I can make a difference in a community I care about, that those things will fill the void and heal the pain. And I was student body president, and I finally had this opportunity to do things that I was passionate about. And it didn't heal the pain. It didn't fill the void. It didn't it didn't give me any kind of reason or rationale to continue to stay in the closet, because I had said to myself, if I make change, if I do good, it'll make staying in the closet, it'll make this pain all worthwhile, and maybe it'll make it go away. And when I was student body president, getting to do this work, not only did it not go away, but it grew worse, it grew deeper, because as professionally fulfilling as that work was, it only reinforced that I was not doing it as my authentic self. And I thought, God, this could be so fulfilling. I could find so much happiness and joy, but by that point, the pain was so all-consuming that I couldn't think about anything else. It was a concept that was on my mind to the point where I just had to reimagine to function through the day. I had to reimagine my experience as being out, even though I was still in the closet. And so, if anything, it was through that experience that I realized the only way to address this pain is to come out. You can't address it through good work and good deeds, through professional fulfillment, through making other people proud. The only way you can heal is to address this head on and to come out. And in many ways, that process to coming out was sort of, I went through different stages of grief. And by the end, I landed on acceptance. And that acceptance of myself could only come from accepting the loss of a future. Because again, Amanda Simpson was that one example of someone, but I still thought there's no way. There's no way. There might be one or two exceptions, but there's no way that I can be out and find love, do work that I love, live in a community I love. And so I kind of mourned a future.
So you retreated.
So I retreated from that future.
Yes.
In order to find myself inside. And eventually I mourned the potential for a future that I wanted, accepted the loss of that, but was also able to accept myself in that moment. And you shouldn't have to give up on a future. You shouldn't have to mourn a future in order to be yourself, but that was the reality at that point. But then in coming out, I came out on the last day of my term as student body president at American. I came out publicly because I always say, get your news out in your own terms, on your own words. And I thought maybe if I can share my story, people might be able to empathize a little bit. It might stop people from making jokes about it. And in coming out, every fear that I had of this world coming crashing down around me, of rejection in every sense of the word, all of those fears, as understandable as they were, failed to materialize. And it was the first instance where I thought, one, wow, when we share our stories, when we share ourselves, when we allow people into our journeys and we share a bit of our vulnerability, it changes the conversation. And two, from that, it was the first moment where I thought, maybe those exceptions that I saw, maybe they don't have to be the exception. Maybe they can be real for me too. Maybe I can live authentically and pursue my dreams all at the same time.
And your dream was always then to be a leader to be in politics, or a filmmaker?
Yeah, so.
Or back to art and politics.
In high school, I was like, I'm gonna be. This is embarrassing. I was like, I'm gonna be a famous director, and then I'm gonna run for president. I'm gonna do Ronald Reagan. But it was to be in government. It was to have some role, whether it was running for office or being on staff or being an advocate fighting for change at a nonprofit. I knew I wanted to be in government or around government because to me, that was the place where every avenue of society converges and where you can make the most amount of change for the most number of people in the most number of ways possible. And so, you know, politics is this thing where you have to pretend like you never wanted to go into politics growing up, or you have to pretend like you have zero ambition. But for me, you know, I was drawn to politics because of my own struggle with who I am. I thought, I can make this world work for more people, including people like me. Mm-hmm. And I thought if I could make the world work for other people, then I could almost live, you know, vicariously through their authenticity. So I found my love for politics there. But at the end of the day, I fell in love with it. I fell in love with politics here in Delaware because one person can make a real difference.
Did you come back after when you graduated? Did you come back to Delaware?
So I came back here for a couple of months to work on a non-discrimination bill, to fight for a non-discrimination bill protecting trans people from discrimination in employment and housing, public spaces. Actually worked really closely with Beau on that bill. He stuck his neck out and put the full force of his office behind it, and we were able to pass it really because he did that. And knowing that Delaware was eventually going to be safe for me to come back to, knowing that I would eventually be able to come here and not be fired from a job or kicked out of a restaurant simply because of my gender identity, I actually went back to DC because I wanted to, one, fight for the change that we had won here in Delaware nationally, but two, also because I had fallen in love with a guy named Andrew Cray, who was a transgender man. He'd come out about 3 years before
me. Did you meet him at college?
I met him, we actually met in what I was interning in the White House, and we met while I was interning in 2012.
Those political romances.
Yes.
There's always one in the campaign. Was it a campaign year?
No, well, it was a campaign year, but I was in the White House, interning in the White House. He was an advocate. He was 3 years older than me. He was an attorney, and he was working on implementation of the Affordable Care Act as an attorney at the Center for American Progress. And he was working specifically to make sure that the Affordable Care Act protected LGBTQ people in healthcare, which it does. And he was successful in helping to secure those protections in 2015. So we fell in love. He Facebook messaged me. We had run into each other at a couple of things, including at events in the White House. And he Facebook messaged me and he said, "I think we'd get along swimmingly." And I thought, who the hell says the word swimmingly? Particularly what 23, 24-year-old says that? I thought, but someone who's probably really goofy. And I'm really goofy, and that's the most important trait in a partner for me. So I said yes to the date. And he was the kindest, smartest, funniest person, most down-to-earth person that I've ever met. You know, a lot of times right now, I think in society, we really struggle with how to be both funny and kind at the same time. He was able to be funny
without being cutting, with a little bite,
but without being mean.
Yeah.
And he never took himself too seriously, but he always took what he did seriously. And so I moved to DC to be with him, to work with him, and to live with him.
And where is he?
So he is no longer with us. He passed away from cancer. We, as two young people in 2013, we were falling in love. We started working together at the Center for American Progress, fighting for LGBTQ equality. And it seemed like we had a world of possibility
before
us.
The whole world ahead of you.
The whole world ahead of us. About a year or so into our relationship, he was diagnosed with oral cancer, cancer of the tongue. It had spread to his lymph nodes. He was lucky to have health insurance. We were lucky to have inclusive benefits that allowed him to take time off work to get care, went to Johns Hopkins, ended up undergoing a 12-hour surgery that left him having to relearn how to talk, how to eat, how to breathe. Left me as his caregiver, suctioning his tracheostomy tube, tending to wounds where they had to reconstruct his tongue with his arm. Left me just being there, as any family who deals with cancer knows, just to
watch
him.
The destruction
and to be there through the destruction. And he got a clean bill of health, but the cancer came back, and when it came back, it spread to his lungs. And so we were still dating at this point. He asked me to marry him in August of 2014. He said when his cancer came back, there was a period of a couple of days between when he got the news that it had come back and had spread and when the doctors officially told him that it was terminal. I knew, my brother's a radiation oncologist, and at one point I was pressing him during the first round of treatment. I said, what happens if this comes back? And my brother told me that the most likely scenario would be that if it came back and spread, it would spread to his lungs, in which case it would be terminal. And so Andy said to me when he found out that the cancer had come back, he said, if it turns out to be terminal, will you marry me? And I said to him, I didn't want to say yes, because I thought if I say yes in this moment, that means that I'm acknowledging that I think this might be terminal. And I knew that it was, but I didn't want to be the one who conveyed that. And so I said, let's not start thinking like that yet. And he went to a follow-up appointment, and the doctor told him that he probably had about 12 months left to live. And so after that appointment, I said to him, you know, and to the question that you asked me the other day, of course the answer is yes. We initially were going to get married. That was August. We were initially going to get married in the fall of that year, but his health began to deteriorate pretty rapidly. And 2 weeks after his terminal diagnosis, I said, I know we're talking about the fall, but maybe we move it up. And he knew what that meant. But I said, yeah, let's move it up. Our friends organized a wedding for us on the rooftop of our apartment building. He was back home. He was dozing in and out of pretty much sleep most of the time, but he wanted to get married. So they organized this beautiful wedding on the rooftop of our apartment building in DC in 5 days. Our colleague, a guy named Bishop Gene Robinson, who was a former Episcopal bishop, first openly gay bishop in any Christian denomination, was kind enough to help organize and preside, officiate. And so we married Andy in a wheelchair on oxygen. And then the next day, we went to try to start getting the treatment that would hopefully prolong his life for the full 12 months. But if he had started treatment, it would have killed him instantly. And so they said, we can't start treatment. And we actually think he needs to just stay in the hospital. And so the next 4 days, everyone who was at the wedding, planning the wedding, gathered around his hospital room. And I slept by his side. And 4 days after we married, he passed away. But I am so, as difficult as that experience was, I am so grateful to have had the time that I had with Andy. I feel like we had a lifetime of love in about 3 years. And it taught me so much, that experience. It taught me about how to love, how to be loved. It left me with a permanent, frankly, a permanent sense of both how fortunate I am to be alive, how precious life is, but also, I don't know if you've experienced this. I'm sure you have. When Beau was struggling with cancer, but one of the things my brother said is that this is going to be incredibly difficult, but you should take stock in the acts of amazing grace that will fill your life. And truly, that grace was everywhere. The miracles were everywhere. And for me, I feel like I almost have a perpetual rose-colored glasses about the world now, because even when things are bad, I can't help but see the grace that I first saw in those last few weeks of Andy's life. I can't help but see those acts of grace everywhere.
And as in simple acts of kindness?
Simple acts of kindness. Simple acts of kindness that just, that not only can be the difference between life and death for a person in that moment, but collectively change things, collectively save communities, collectively save lives, collectively change the world. And so I still feel like my cup runneth over with love from that relationship with Andy, and I still draw on that every single day.
Well, truly, Sarah McBride, it's your character and your strength and your light and your wisdom and your empathy and your grace that we all benefit from. I mean, had you not, and you've walked the walk, and had you, I don't know, but I would think it'd be very, for most people, if I hadn't walked the walk, I wouldn't know how to act. But I'm listening to you and the little snippets that you've told me about your journey. I can taste and feel a little of it. And what you have done is your wisdom and your knowledge has given me that little bit more degree of empathy. And that's what we are sorely missing in our country today. So you are shaping this woman and this community and this United States of America and making us all better for it, for knowing you and for just listening and trying to understand. I don't understand all of it because
none of us can know.
But thank God for you. You know, you are hope and you are joy. You're not mean. You're not ugly. You're not divisive. You are a living, breathing. My mom said, you know, the character of a man or woman is determined by simple acts of kindness. And what you have done for this woman's move is you're living that all politics is personal. So thank you, Sarah McBride. You said silly is one of the things that you are?
Goofy, absolutely.
Goofy? Okay, I have some goofy questions for you, okay? And as a Biden, I have to start out with this one. What's your favorite ice cream?
Chocolate chip cookie dough.
I think I might know this answer. What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
Actually, it's not filmmaking or architecture. It's to be a travel writer. I am obsessed with Rick Steves.
Oh, here. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think life is... The joy of life for me will be the change that I bring in the places that I see. And I love to travel, and so travel writing would be my dream job.
Okay, I thought you were going to say architect. So
you can throw architecture in there because you write about the architecture of the places you go.
Okay, I'm with you. I'm going with you on this thing. So one word to describe you.
Tenacious.
Favorite TV show?
The Crown, perhaps.
Favorite music?
Taylor Swift right now.
Do you have a hidden talent?
Play piano. Not very well.
Play at it or play it?
I play at playing piano.
Okay. If you could have a superpower, what would it be?
Teleportation, so I can travel easily.
Oh, yeah, and write all those reports.
That's right.
Yeah, okay. What's your favorite color?
Blue.
What's your birthday? I don't need the year. Oh, the August. You said you're born
August
in August?
9th. I'm a Leo.
Okay. And what's your theme song?
This Is Me from The Greatest Showman.
Oh, yes.
It's a good pump-up song.
All right, kid. Well, give him hell. You're wonderful.
Thank you. So are you.
Thank you. And thank you to the Stavros Niarchos Foundation for their support. And remember, all politics is personal.